Oh my God. Y'all better get yourself together. Welcome to the Ratchet Express, because this Love & Hip Hop franchise with Miami is the most ratchet of them all. I don't know. I can't tell which ones are, I guess, a plan, which scenes are planned, or which of them are just like the way it is. Because I be seeing some of the stuff that Sukiyana and her crew be doing. The outfit she be wearing, everything she be saying, I can't. This is the most ghetto of them all. I don't even know. It's entertaining as hell, but damn. The episode starts off with Amara talking to her mama about her dad stopping her show last episode, wanting to talk to her about getting to know her again, getting back in her life, you know, and whatnot. And some of y'all might hate me for saying this, because I know that some of y'all might say, well, she's her dad, you know, forgiveness is everything. I know all of this. However, I do not care. Why? Because I am so sick of individuals who will make children get out, leave them, and be out of their lives in the moments when they're supposed to pay for them, when they're supposed to influence them, when they're supposed to be in their life and be a present parent. Hell, even a phone call will do. But then when they're grown and you don't feel like the law can come after you to pay nothing, you want to come back into their life and say, well, now I want to get to know you. When you weren't locked up, there's nothing that was in your way of getting to know that girl. You pop into her life, you pop back out. Now that you are in a position where you need her to now finance your life, when you didn't pay for nothing when she was growing up, her mother said that she struggled and she molded Amara to be the successful woman on TV that she is now. And now that she's going through all of this and you need money, you want to come into her life so she can now basically take care of you when in your hour of need. Hell, I wouldn't even give somebody a kidney if that was me, because I feel like you don't deserve it. I'd rather give it to a complete stranger, because I at least don't know their character, whether they're good or bad. In your case, I know that your character is bad. You are selfish by design. And who the hell ever heard of Puerto Rico being the place that you need papers for to come to the United States? Are you serious? I can't. This entirety of his behavior, I was feeling Amara's mama's vibes. I know that it is, you know, some people might say, you know what, if it's your dad, you got to give him a chance. I understand that you got to give him a chance, but I'm feeling the vibes of the mom, because I feel like if it was me and I had children, and y'all know that it is very difficult to raise children by yourself, or one, let alone two, three, four, by yourself when you are poor, trying to figure out how you're going to feed them. She said that she went some days starving because she wanted to make sure her child was good. Put them through school, get them in a good neighborhood, make sure they don't fall into any traps. Amara is well read, she's very intelligent. She didn't come out here and she's very career oriented, she's very driven, she's a hard worker, she's a good spirited individual. And that's a result of how her mama raised her. Hell, she was so mad she was switching between English and Spanish. I was like, damn, you better tell her the truth. As far as me thinking that Amara should go, because Amara seems like she has a big heart, and I know that she's gonna give her father, even though her father does not deserve it. But for me, I'm sticking with the mama. Don't do shit for him. He needs to go ahead. Whatever money that he saved from not taking care of Amara when she was a kid, he needs to use that money and take care of himself now. Not come to me when you didn't do nothing for me and expect me to do something for you. Boy, bye. Anyway, the next scene we got is Briscoe spending time with his child and Shello at the bowling alley, trying to teach his son how to do it. And the way he threw that ball and missed, I laughed. But Briscoe is now going out of his way to get back into Cello's pants, i.e. fix his family. And I'm happy to see it, because he's making an effort, and that's what I'd like to see about a lot of black men going out there and really taking care of their responsibilities and doing whatever they can and being in their children's lives. So I love that scene. Then we got Santana talking to the girl, Sukiyana, and her friend wanting to do a album release party, a release party for his song. But in the midst of this conversation, he brings up the case that we heard not too long ago about him getting shot in the club and him alleging that it was a hate crime, that was, you know, that was what it was. Now, I wasn't there, so I really don't really know, you know, when articles come out. I've heard people who talked about it where they said that it wasn't, and I've heard people who talked about it where they said that it was. When I listened to him talk, the way that he explains it, him being at a club saying he didn't do nothing to anybody, then in that case I would say, well, I guess it is a hate crime. But then when I listened to Tip, and Tip says that she was present and she saw him basically taunting some of the people out there, some of these hood type dudes, who basically taunting about your behavior when you know that they don't, you know, they're trying to get away from you, and not just taunting them, but talking out of your ass, and they reacted. Granted, I don't think you should be shooting nobody for nothing. This is something that, you know, small, but that was the reason behind it. So when I hear from that perspective, I would say that it was done out of anger, not necessarily out of a hate crime from that perspective. But when I hear his side, it sounds like it. So I don't know which side to choose, but because of this issue, he does not want Tip around him, or he feels like Tip should issue him a public apology because she did a public video post for the entire world to see, speaking against what he alleged happened to him. So Sukiyana is trying to explain that, you know, Tip is her manager and she never saw Tip to be that type of person, but maybe Tip can offer an apology for the situation. So he says, okay, well, invite, let her come to the party. The next thing we got is Trina and Joy meeting up with Trick, trying to help Trick lose weight, and Trick with his big ass stomach, having it just with his carefree attitude, shows up trying to first of all give Joy a real hug because she's giving him that church hug with the booty out. He's like, no ma'am, get in here and feel all this bump because I want to get all that. Trick and Joy are so cute. I just wish they would just work it out. I do, because Trick gets into do the workout. He's on a trampoline. You know, Trina's motivating him to, you know, trying to get him to go. He looks so uncomfortable. He didn't even like he wanted to be there. He just looked like, what the hell am I doing here? This is a joke. This scene is just funny. It's too much. And then to add, you know, insult to injury, what he's doing, he's sitting up here, and the guy who's supposed to be training him turns around and starts doing squats and bending over. Trick is like, this is too much for me. That scene had me rolling. It had me dying. Then we got MJ and Amara talking. Oh my gosh, this scene, oh my gosh, oh my word. So MJ is talking to Amara about how he's so happy about her moving on with her career and doing well, and how he's so happy that everything worked out with planning her, you know, the performance she did, you know, stuff like that. And he said, you know, since we can't get married, I don't want to rush you. Since we can't have kids, I want to rush you. But guess what? Let's get a dog, because we're going to have some kind of connection or something between us if there's a dog in the house. Mind you, I don't know if MJ's bringing any money to the household. I haven't seen him bring anything. So far as I'm concerned, Amara's the one getting paid more in Love and Hip Hop. She got her music, and prior to that, when Julian was managing her, he was bringing in some money for her to set her up to the point where she's doing good right now. So to me, MJ, I don't know what he's brought into this relationship besides him wanting to marry her and give her a baby and get her stuck with him forever. But or maybe he was going to claim child support. If she has a baby, he was going to take the baby and tell her to pay him child support so he can finance his career. Because I know he does music, but I've not heard anything from his music. I've not seen him on TV. I've not seen him as an artist. But here he is, after wanting to butter up with a dog, saying, you know what? I think that I should manage you while you look for a manager. What in the fuck? Hell no. Hell no. I've been saying that this man is a pathetic excuse for Amara to be dating right now, because I don't feel like he's genuine when it comes to her. I felt like he was pushing too hard for her to get rid of Julian because he wanted to take Julian's place. I saw what he was doing. I saw him inserting, trying to check Julian. I understood some of the points that he was making, but the extent that he was going at it, I thought it was just foul. I said, no, you don't need to be doing all this. It's not necessary. And I told Amara, you do not divorce Julian until you find yourself another manager, because he is deliberately wanting them to end the contract, knowing that she doesn't have a backup plan. And then when she decided to do on her own, he's like, well, I'm gonna be there to help you, basically to prove his worth as a manager, because if he can't make it in the music industry, he'll try to make it as a manager. And because Amara's on TV, he can put her name on his resume and say, yeah, I've worked with somebody like Amara, so I know what I'm doing. Let me manage other people and make money off of her. You opportunist mother Amara, you better open your eyes, listen to your mama again. Because her mama was trying to tell her about the whole Julian situation, not to rush her decisions. Her mama also told her to watch out for MJ because he's encroaching in their life and doing it all in a very sneaky tip. And she's not listening. Now, he's trying to talk about, let me be your manager. And she's like, I don't want to mix business with pleasure. Bitch, don't mix anything with him at all. Get rid of him. Oh my God. Oh, I can't. Anyway, Santana's party comes up. And everybody, you know, he's doing his song. Everybody's enjoying it. You know, Sukiyana's there. Shay's there. They're all bopping to his song. Tip, with her fine self, is walking up. And here she is trying to get in it. There's a no trespassing sign. Telling her not to come in. Oh, my God. I was like, who? This is petty to the 10th power. You went out of your way to create a sign, put this woman's face on it, and have a security guard out there to tell her that she was trespassing on a party that you invited her to, because she didn't issue a public apology because he wanted a public apology. Tip doesn't strike me as what people would call a homophobe, because Tip herself likes girls as well. She said it herself. So I don't feel like her saying whatever she said about Santana was coming from a hateful place. She's speaking by what she saw. At the same time, Santana is really wanting her to go, just like she publicly spoke out on him, to publicly apologize so that way he can save face and make sure everybody knows that he was telling the truth, because that's his truth. And to do that, to make sure he gets his point across, he has her outside to a party that he invited her to. And Shade, everybody coming out there. Sukiyana's over here yelling, "Oh my God, you're not finna have my girl out here," with her big ass. Sukiyana, I love her, because she is funny and I feel like she's good vibes, genuinely, but she does the most. But anyway, Tip and her fine self ended up going because Santana wasn't gonna let her in. It's his party. He can decide who can come and who cannot, and that's just what it is. And in the party, you got Trina's old manager, the dude that was gonna fight Bobby, walks up to Sukiyana and says, "Hey, y'all want a new manager. I could help you guys. I could really do this. I work with Trina." But I remember Trina firing him, so I don't know. And I thought he was working with Trick at the restaurant. What happened? What is all these people? Is this a joke? I don't even know which storyline is true anymore, or if it is true. I just don't get it. Mona, this ratchet stuff that you have us watching is getting to the point where I don't believe nothing no more. Make it make sense, woman. Anyway, prima donna, after meeting up with Amara at Santana's party, and Amara letting her know that she feels like, you know, she's a little bit concerned about what MJ's saying to her, and prima donna saying, you know, I never know MJ to be that type of person, but you never know. She now goes and she meets up with her friend Annie, or Annie, I don't know her name. She meets up with her, and it turns out that this girl is MJ's ex. And this girl says everything that I was thinking, everything that I was trying to say to Amara through the screen, but she wasn't hearing me. That MJ drained her entire bank account to try to finance his career. Because as a musician, you don't make no money. He didn't want to go to work and make money, so he used her to finance his career. And years later, it didn't go nowhere. So he wasted all her money, didn't give her a marriage, didn't give her nothing, and then went on to the next person that he felt would get her far in life, hence Amara. And as we see on the next episode, when they show the preview, Amara says that everything that this woman told her is everything that she's experiencing with MJ, because she feels like MJ has not been bringing any money, except he's been using some of hers. Amara is finally going to see the light, because she needs to start listening to herself more. She knows what her spirit is telling her. I don't care if he is Shay's brother. Tell Shay, your friend, that her brother needs a little bit of lesson on how to be by himself, support himself, get his own career, because right now his career is like down there. And we never heard of him. I never heard of him. Now that he's associated with Amara, we all hear him as MJ Amara's boyfriend. You still don't have a independent title of your own, but you're trying to ride her coattail and drain her bank account like you did the last girl. Bye-bye. This episode was entertaining. I did prefer it better than the Love and Hip Hop episode they just did. This one was a lot better for me. It's ratchet. It gave me all the drama, the messiness. I saw it all. I enjoyed it. However, I'm hoping that moving forward up to the reunion, we need a little bit more oomph to keep going. Otherwise, I'm going to lose interest. Okay, y'all tell me what y'all think about this episode below. Let me know what y'all think about MJ, because I'm branding him as an opportunist for real. That's where I stand. I don't care how angry he is next episode, but from what I'm seeing and from what I mean, the way that he's moving, it's kind of sneaky. Like, he already kind of fast forward to how he's gonna fuck up Amara's life and swoop in like he's the savior, talking about, "I want the best for you." Boy, bye. Anyway, like, subscribe, and notification bell, and I will see y'all some other time when I do another review or when I talk about something important. Okay, love you. Bye.